let's start with the president's tweet that came in at 11:24 last night because most people were sleeping. And so this is what's happened overnight. The president, in all caps, has tweeted to the Iranian president Rouhani, never, ever threaten the United States again, or you will suffer consequences the likes of which few throughout history have ever suffered before. We are no longer a country that will stand for your demented words of violence and death. Be cautious! Exclamation point. So, Max Boot, I mean, look, we, you know, so often are left to try to figure out why the president is tweeting what he's tweeting at the time that he's tweeting. And as you know, after the head-slapping Helsinki moment that, you know, saw his approval ratings in terms of how he's dealing with Russia drop, I think that, you know, we have to ask the question of, did this have to happen last night? Is this a distraction of some kind? And just to prove the point, it is President Trump, it's Donald Trump himself, before he was president, who planted the seed that you may want to go after Iran if you need a distraction. Here are his tweets about President Obama in 2013. I predict that President Obama will at some point attack Iran in order to save face. That was from September 2013. Here's one from 2011. He was already thinking about it. In order to get elected, Barack Obama will start a war with Iran. So we know that that has at times been on the president's mind. How do you see what came in last night?
Well, you're right, Allison, that Trump is kind of a master of projection and also distraction. I mean, with any previous president, if you'd woken up to this all caps tweet threatening war with Iran, you'd think he probably belongs in a padded cell. But with Trump, this is kind of business as normal. He had a very rough week last week. He was raked over the coals for his subservience to Russia. And so I guess it's as predictable as the sun coming up in the morning that he's going to try to start a crisis elsewhere. At the end of last week, he tried to resurrect the issue with NFL players kneeling during the playing of the anthem. That didn't work so well. So now he's going to gin up a threat of war with Iran. Of course, you know, with Trump, it's a little bit hard to take him seriously at this point, because if the North Korean example is anything to go by, you know, now he's threatening war with Iran. But within a year, he'll be saying that Hassan Rouhani is brilliant, smart, funny, witty, fine personality, and he'll be reaching a very lenient deal with Iran that will be far less stringent than the Iran nuclear deal that he blew up.
Hey, look, as Barbara Starr laid out, basically he has nothing to show for the North Korean meetings, at least not yet. As we all saw last week, he was embarrassed by these meetings with Vladimir Putin and has tried to clean it up day after day after day, although apparently stopped trying to clean that up last night. But David Sanger, there is something going on with Iran over the last few weeks. The leader there, Rouhani, has threatened to close the Straits of Hormuz to oil, which would cause a huge economic disruption. And the president is trying to take advantage of that moment. Explain.
Sure. So the start of this, John, of course, was the president's decision to pull out of the 2015 Iran nuclear agreement and then to pressure all of the European allies to go reimpose sanctions. Now, he's running into a lot of trouble on that. He's running into it with the French. He's running into it even with the British, certainly with the Russians and the Chinese. And they're all saying, look, Iran was complying with the agreement, so that the crisis was created by the United States' decision to pull out. President Rouhani in Iran obviously has got to make some kind of case to his own people that if the United States reimposes sanctions, if it punishes foreign firms that do business with them, that somehow or another he's got to go respond. And, you know, so far, it's interesting. I was with a good number of intelligence people out at a conference that was running through the weekend. They have seen no evidence of the Iranians restarting the nuclear program despite the pullout from the agreement. So Rouhani had to, of course, go make this case that he would go interfere with shipping in the Persian Gulf. That would be a pretty ridiculous thing for him to do. And, of course, the United States has got the Fifth Fleet out there. But the president's response last night, I think, left a lot of people thinking that the wording was an exact echo of what he did with North Korea last summer. He thinks that wording brought North Korea to the table.
John, I don't want to go full wag the dog, but, I mean, we know that the president's strategy...
It's a half wag.
I mean...
It's a half wag. It goes to here, not to there.
Very subtle wag.
The president's strategy, he's employed it over and over. We would be foolish not to absorb it and recognize it. When he's embarrassed as he was last week. He always looks for a distraction. And coupled that with the idea that he also may be embarrassed by North Korea because it's not going the way that he promised, and they're now reneging on things that he thought that he had gotten. So how are we to interpret what's happening with Iran?
Look, I think this escalated very quickly late on a Sunday on top of a speech by Mike Pompeo at the Reagan Library. Very tough on Iran, explosive accusations, including Rouhani running a $95 billion hedge fund, allegedly. But it's that escalation of words in an all-cap from the president late at night that is really about war. Look, you used the tweets earlier. We know that he's talked about presidents using war as a political distraction. There's no question that his rhetoric in North Korea does not meet reality. There is not any evidence of denuclearization. In fact, the opposite. That must be embarrassing to him. But setting up another fight with Iran, escalating very quickly, isn't only politically dangerous. Obviously, it's geostrategically destabilizing. And there's a contradiction here. Because while he's trying to cozy up to Russia, Russia is backing Iran in Syria. So these coalitions don't make any sense. We know the animus there. We know this is only second to Hillary Clinton in terms of uniting elements of Donald Trump's base. But this is a threat of war, folks. Make no mistake.
Yeah, his good friend Vladimir Putin is exactly the guy who could lean on Iran. If he wanted to get something done with Iran or to put pressure on them, ask the guy that he had a 2.5-hour meeting with that supposedly went so well. The one thing Putin said about Iran in the news conference after was actually talking about how he wishes the United States hadn't pulled out of the nuclear deal. So it's not clear that the president got what he wanted out of that. Max, look. This is, if you listen to liberal critics of the president, this is their worst nightmare. They've always said, we're worried that his words are going to start a war here. We're worried about what he might do to save himself politically. That is a genuine fear here. However, look, I mean, Barbara Starr is reporting there's no movement from the Iranian military. As far as we know, this is just hot words from the president. In his head, this is a rehashing of the greatest hits with North Korea, saying, hey, that worked great.
Yeah, that's exactly right, John. I mean, it is worth noting, I think, the extent to which this actually further highlights his subservience to Putin, because you've seen that he's willing to make threats to Rouhani, to Kim, to other leaders around the world. He's not willing to make any kind of threats to Putin or Russia.
Right.
But in terms of the raising the risk of war, which is certainly what he seems to be doing with this tweet, I mean, that is a real concern. I mean, I was actually out in the Gulf last year aboard the USS Nimitz in the Persian Gulf, and they are always poised on the knife edge of war. I mean, they are constantly being probed by the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps, their Navy, their drones overhead. There's always a risk of an incident, and this kind of incendiary rhetoric from the American president certainly raises that concern, even though I don't think Trump is ever actually going to launch a war against Iran, because I think what we saw in the case of North Korea, he is more bark than bite. And one of the more interesting things he's been reported as saying is that when John Bolton came in, it's been reported that Trump told him, you know, hey, I know you like wars. I don't like wars, so let's stay out of wars. And so I think that's, you know, the power of his threats, I think, is waning a little bit because other leaders around the world are taking his measure. And I think what they are concluding is that he is a blustery guy. He is full of BS. He is full of over-the-top rhetoric. He is willing to launch trade wars for sure. But there is so far no real evidence that he is willing to launch a shooting war. So therefore, I'm not sure how effective these threats against Iran are actually going to be.